So I'm Anusha, and I'm actually a machine learning enthusiast. I'm constantly learning myself every day. And today I'm here to share about one of my hobby projects, which was text summarization. Basically, what is text summarization? It is passing in some text. Could be an article, could be some text from social media, anything, and outputting some sequence of text again. And all around us, we're overwhelmed with so much information these days that all of us could definitely do with some summarization to understand the gist of a big source of text. So basically, that's why I got interested in this area. And it... what just happened? Okay, we're back on. So I'll go in a little bit about the different kinds of text summarization that we have. So the two main kinds, extractive text summarization and abstractive text summarization. Today we're focusing on abstractive, but just to understand the difference, if you see over here, extractive is a bit lengthier than abstractive text summarization. What extractive text summarization does is it extracts words and phrases from some input data to form a summary. And abstractive text summarization is more human-like in nature. The aim of the model is to learn an internal language representation and paraphrase the intent of the text, rather than extracting the words from the text. So what we can do to get started with abstractive text summarization, this is something that Dr. Martin Andrews covered earlier, but for any kind of project like this, you would need to do some data processing. And that would involve using any kind of data set that you want. Over here, I used a data set of short articles, and I used a pretty small data set because I don't have a GPU and I needed everything to be as efficient as possible. So the first thing I did here was to filter out unnecessary characters, special characters that are not needed, and sentences, for example, which are too long or too short. I've removed those. And next would be to tokenize the articles into words. So we don't care about the sequence, the order of the words. We just have a bunch of words, and all of those words are the input for our model. And from then, we'd create word embeddings so that these words are represented in a numeric manner. And like we've mentioned already, two ways to do that would be Word2Vec and Glove. Over here, I've used TensorFlow, and TensorFlow actually does the word embeddings internally, so I've not actually had the need to work out Word2Vec or Glove in this case. So these are some examples. For example, a human would know that there is some relevance between Spain and Madrid, but a computer would never know that Spain and Madrid are related in any way. So that's where these word embeddings come in, and this is what TensorFlow will be doing for us. Now we'll move on to the architecture that we're going to be using. In text summarization, we'd use a sequence-to-sequence model. And a sequence-to-sequence model is basically made up of a recurrent neural network. So this is, again, something that we've covered, but this is how a neural network looks like. The hidden layer in the neural network uses both inputs and its own outputs to process the next state, to come up with the next state. And this is how the basic RNN would look like. And in our RNN, we're basically using stacked LSTM cells. This is how they look like. We have input gates, output gates, and forget gates to control the state of the LSTM. Now we look at the sequence-to-sequence model. So this is basically what the sequence-to-sequence model would do is take in a sequence and output a sequence, which is why it's called sequence to sequence. And to do that, we use two recurrent neural networks. The encoder over here that you see, that is one RNN, and the decoder is another RNN. What the encoder does is it takes in an input sequence and comes up with an encoded intermediate sequence. Then the decoder uses that intermediate sequence and decodes that to form words again. And we'll look at the code later on, but basically that's the idea behind a sequence-to-sequence model. Opening up the code. Okay. We'll start off with data processing. So over here, as you can see, I'm just going to go through this code real quick. We're going to be loading whatever data that you want, that you have, and tokenizing that data to form the words. Here we're doing filtering to make sure we've got the exact kind of data that we want, sentences that are not too long or not too short, for example. And then we're going to index the data. We're going to create a dictionary index to word and word to index. And we're going to come up with a set of vocabulary. And this is one extra step that we would do, that is to pad the sequences that we have. So as you know, the input sequences that you will have won't all be the same exact same size. And for it to work in a sequence-to-sequence model, you would need to pad the sequence with zeros. So that's what we've done over here. Pad the input sequence and the labels with zeros. And then we save the final version of data that we have. Now, TensorFlow has a sequence-to-sequence module, and we can, for any of these kind of projects, you can use something like that. So over here, I've built a wrapper over the sequence-to-sequence functions that we have. We are basically building a graph, which is your model. It has the LSTM cells, and it's using the dropout method, which is a way to, it's a regularization method to prevent overfitting of the data. And we're going to be training in batches. So that's all of this. Over here, if you can see, we're going to train all the training data in batches. And here's a function to predict your output sequence given some new sequence that the model has not seen. And let's go back to the slides. Might have been in the downloads. Okay, back to the slides. So now that we've seen how the code looks like, we can take a look at how this model can be trained. If you have a GPU, this would be very easy, but I didn't have a GPU, so I trained it on an Amazon P2 instance. And some of the results that I got are down here. So basically, this leaders begin arriving for Commonwealth Summit. That was the headline of a short article that I had that I tested with. And this was predicted quite well. The headline was, the model was able to form the headline quite well. But if you look at the other two sequences that we had, Croatians vote in three constituencies, the model wasn't able to form much. It came up with just constituencies and constituencies. So as we can see, there are variable results. For certain kinds of articles, the model was able to predict pretty well the summaries, but for certain kinds of articles, it wasn't able to come up with the headlines properly. And of course, all this boils down to the kinds of parameters you set, and also a lot of other factors. I've constructed a very basic model here, which is probably why you're seeing these kind of results. And definitely, there is a lot of room for improvement. For example, if you're going to be trying this yourself, you could also try doing weight decay. You could try doing word embeddings on your own instead of relying on what TensorFlow is doing for you. And apart from all of this, if you're going to try this yourself, you don't have to stick to just articles and headlines. You could also try with language translation, could be English to French, French to English. And you could also use social media posts and responses and recipes, anything. So the sequence-to-sequence model need not be used only for articles. It could be used for a lot of different kinds of data. With that, I would like to wrap up. Pass it on to you.
Good
question. Tried a few different times.
What was the hardest part?
I would have to say it was the sequence to sequence bit. The math behind it isn't all that straightforward, because underneath it there are recurrent neural networks and LSTMs. So I wasn't very satisfied with just using the modules straight out of TensorFlow, so I wanted to go a little bit deeper and understand the math behind it, which is why I found it a little bit difficult to grasp it fully. That part took me quite a bit of time. Thank you.
Can you elaborate a bit more on what sequence went in and what sequence was out?
Sure. So the sequence that went in was the article description itself. Can I look at the GitHub? I've got the text file here, and you'd be able to understand the input and the output a little bit better.
Which one is yours? This one, right?
Yeah. So the input was a short article. Something like this. This is in a JSON format. And the output was the headline of that article. Which was something like this. So this was the data that was used for training. The article description, the text, and the headline of that article. And in the prediction, the description was used, and the output sequence was supposed to be the headline of that text. Yeah. For me, it was taking a really long time to train when I kept all the long sentences. Plus, the results weren't as good because there were some sentences that were really short and some that were really long. And I think that discrepancy caused, that difference caused the results to be bad. And so I decided to, so basically, this was after some research, but the way that I could make it better was to shorten those sentences, make the differences between the length of the sentences a little bit smaller. Yes. No, actually, I have not tried that, but definitely it would be something interesting to play with. Anything else? Any other questions? If not, we're good. Thank you.